Well, good morning, church.
Good morning.
Hey, praise God. It's a beautiful day, and I'm so glad you're here today. We're going to be talking about the Father's love today, and so I want to welcome each of you here and wish you God's blessings on your worship. At the end of the service, I ask that you would just stick around just a little bit. We're going to go ahead and show you some of the slides from Vacation Bible School. It was a lot of fun. There was a lot of energy, and the children that attended really enjoyed themselves. And again, a shout out of thanks for all the support every night, people serving meals and helpers and song leaders and things like that. It was just wonderful. It really, really, really was. Also, I just wanted to let you know that if you're interested in finding out, if you weren't able to attend the congregational meeting and you'd like to know a little bit about what happened, you know, the minutes haven't, I don't think, I haven't received them yet. If they have, I apologize, but I haven't seen them yet. But if you're interested in finding out a little bit about that, just need to ask, and then we can let you know exactly, you know, what went down, and you can read those for yourself as we have that. But the announcements are in here, and we are also going to be having a baptism at the second service, so that's another exciting time. Well, I don't have any others. There's an announcement that maybe some of you have that needs to be spoken this morning. All right. Well, O Jesus, King Most Wonderful is our opening song, and we're going to be processing in. So as you see the cross come in, please rise, face the cross, and if you're wondering, oh, I have to look at the music because I want to sing. There's a monitor in the back. Just look at the back and you'll read it and then transition to this one. As you do that, that's what I do. So let's go ahead and begin.
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
In you, O Lord, do I take refuge. Let me never be put to shame.
In your righteousness, deliver me.
I trust in you, O Lord, I say, you are my God.
My times are in your hands.
Make your face shine on your servant.
Save me in your steadfast love.
O God, our Father, since you have set forth the way of life for us in your beloved Son, we confess with shame our slowness to learn of him, our failure to follow him, and our reluctance to bear the cross.
Have mercy on us and forgive us, O Lord.
Forgive us the poverty of our worship, our neglect of fellowship and the means of grace, our hesitating witness for Christ, or evasion of responsibility in your service, and our imperfect stewardship of your gifts.
Have mercy on us and forgive us, O Lord.
Forgive us that we have been thoughtless in our judgments, hasty in condemnation, grudging in forgiveness, slow to seek reconciliation, and unwilling to help our neighbors as we ought.
Have mercy on us, O God, according to your steadfast love, creating us clean hearts, O God, and put a new and right spirit within us.
Upon your confession and by the command of our Lord Jesus Christ, I, as a called servant of Christ, and by his authority, forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless until the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful. He will surely do it. Go in peace.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
At this time, let's go ahead and share the peace of Christ with one another. Let's have a word of prayer together. Almighty eternal God, in your word, the word of your apostles and prophets, you have promised and you have proclaiming your saving will, promised to be with us always. Grant us faith to believe your promises, that we may receive eternal salvation through Jesus Christ our Lord. He lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. Our first greeting comes to us from Exodus chapter 19, beginning with the second verse, where we hear a promise back in the Old Testament of what God's people were to be, a kingdom of priests. They set out from Rephidim and came into the wilderness of Sinai, and they encamped in the wilderness. There Israel encamped before the mountain while Moses went up to God. The Lord God called him out of the mountain, saying, "Thus you shall say to the house of Jacob, tell the people of Israel, you yourselves have seen what I did to the Egyptians and how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now, therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession among all peoples, for all the earth is mine, and you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words that you shall speak to the people of Israel." So Moses came and called the elders of the people and set before them all these words that the Lord had commanded him. All the people answered together and said, "All that the Lord has spoken, we will do." And Moses reported the words of the people to the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
From Psalm 100, a responsive reading, women and men also separated with their readings. "Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth.
Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing.
Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise.
Give thanks to him. Bless his name.
And his faithfulness to all generations. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen." Our second reading comes from Romans chapter 5 and 6. "For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since therefore we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we now receive reconciliation. Therefore, just as sin came in the world through one man and death through sin, so death spread to all men because all sinned. For sin indeed was in the world before the law was given, but sin is not counted where there is no law. Yet death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over those whose sinning was not like the transgression of Adam, who is a type of the one who is to come. But the free gift is not like the trespass. For if many die through one man's trespass, much more have the grace of God and the free gift by the grace of that one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for many." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised.
And his greatness is unsearchable.
On your wondrous works I will meditate.
And I will declare.
Alleluia, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few.
Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest.
Alleluia. Please stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 9th and 10th chapters.
Glory to you, O Lord.
"And Jesus went throughout all the cities and villages, teaching in the synagogues and proclaiming the kingdom, the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every disease and every affliction. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them, because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. And he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." And he called to him his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal every disease and every affliction. The names of the 12 apostles are first Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew his brother, James the son of Zebedee, and John his brother, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew the tax collector, James the son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, Simon the Zealot, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out, instructing them, "Go nowhere among the Gentiles and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, and proclaim as you go, saying, 'The kingdom of heaven is at hand.' Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse lepers, cast out demons. You receive without pay, give without pay." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated for our sermon hymn, "God loved the world so that he gave." I wonder if they have pink sandals, white White's hymns today.
You got the White's hymns on.
How you guys doing?
Good.
I'm glad you're doing good. I'm doing good too. My life is so awesome. So did you have pizza and grapes last week? Did you eat grapes last week? Do you know? Do you think so? You have any pizza? I'm just wondering, because remember last week you said those were your
favorite. That's great at our house.
You do? Good. Your favorite.
And we were eating pizza.
Good job, Dad and Mom. I'm telling you, that's awesome, Dad. Yeah. You know, I wanted to ask you another question. Do you know what you're having for dinner tonight? No? Do you know what you're going to be doing tomorrow?
Yeah.
You do what? You just know. Okay. What about next week? What about 5 years from now? You know you're going to be 5 years from now? What about 10 years from now? Well, you're making me scratch my head because I'm not sure you really know what you're going to be doing 10 years from now, do you? You mean she does. Okay. Let that one go. All right. Well, I'm trying to tell you something. Did you know that your mom and dad have already made plans for you for later? And for your older sister, too, for later? They looked way ahead, and they're already making plans for your school, for what's going to happen after you go to grade school and your high school. They already know what's going to happen. They think they have an idea about college. They're already thinking about college for you. And who knows, they may be already praying for the man you might meet someday that you might get married for. It's a really neat prayer that parents can pray when their child is still very young. You're praying for that future person they're going to marry. Moms and dads, they have to plan way ahead, because they know that if they don't plan way ahead, it's going to be really hard when they get there to try to hurry up and make it all happen. Now, Jesus in our story today, he planned way ahead, but we don't always see that being revealed. God planned ahead too. He planned way ahead to say, you know what? I know where they're going to be when they leave the earth, when they die. They're going to be with me. And so he made plans. And in order to do that, he sent his son Jesus way ahead to die on the cross, so that when you get all grown up and then you live, and then finally one day you're done here on earth and you're going to go, you'll be in heaven. That's planning way ahead. And that's a lot about what the Father's love is today, planning way ahead. So, what are you going to be doing? What sport are you in? Soccer. You're going to be in soccer again this year, you think? You know that. You're planning way ahead. And what do you like to do?
Tumbling.
Yeah? So when are you going to be tumbling again this year? Yes, you know you are. So you can plan way ahead.
I have to go all day swimming.
Like all day tumbling?
Yeah.
Wow.
I go with Nana.
You do go with Nana. That's wonderful. Well, will you have an echo prayer with me? And they'll help. Okay, we'll all echo prayer. Will you pray with me? Okay. Dear God, thank you for sending Jesus way ahead. So I will be with you forever. Thank you for soccer. And thank you for tumbling. Amen. All right, go back and sit down. Thanks so much. You like tumbling. God's grace, mercy, and peace to each and every one of you from God our Father, through our Lord and our Savior Jesus. Amen. I invite you to follow along in the SPL News. The outline is there for you as we move into today's sermon and message for today. What kind of God do we have? Well, We're going to be opening God's Word today in our minds, and we've already read God's Word. We're getting into God's Word. He reveals Himself as we spoke last week. It's right there for us. He opens to us His heart. And if I were to say, what kind of God do you have? We might find probably 15 or 20 different answers. Some might say we have a God of love. Others might say we have a God who's firm, a strong God, a powerful God. And then we're going to get into the attributes of God. He's omniscient. He's all-knowing. He's omnipresent. He's everywhere. He's omnipotent. He's all-powerful. His steadfast love endures forever. He's wise. And you would all be correct, because that's how God reveals Himself. People like to pigeonhole people, like to pigeonhole other people, and they like to do the same with God. They like to take an attribute of God and apply that to where God wants to show mercy instead of judgment or discipline. They want to put love in the case where there are rules and there are choices that are right and wrong, and they want to say, well, let's use an attribute of God, how God reveals Himself, to override maybe a truth or a part of the law that's written in our hearts or has been revealed to us in Holy Scripture. Now, fathers' love can be shown by what they do and what they say. In fact, that's the opening line for your outline. Fathers can be shown by their actions and their words. And as I was looking at the idea of a father's love, and today being Father's Day, it occurred to me that there's some pretty fascinating stories out there in regards to fathers and grandfathers. Maybe you've got the papa or pawpaw, and you've got all these other names for fathers, and you're hopefully been able to honor not only them today, but maybe even their legacy of the way they used to live. You know, I know that I've heard the story where you see a person who is older now, and they're wiser, they've lived longer, but they're different, you know. And I think I've shared this story where grandparents have decided that they're going to be very, very generous, and I can't remember when growing up how they weren't generous. You know, now that, you know, there's grandfathers, you know, one story is about a grandfather who can't wait to give money to his grandkids. You know, growing up, if we were to ask our father about that, he might get stories like, you know, 50 cents in my day went a lot longer than 50 cents in your day, and I had to walk uphill both ways to go to work and work hard all day until I got that money. And you know, and now this same man is coming in going, let's see how much money I have for my little grandbaby. Let's see how much change we have in my pocket. How wonderful they are. An article entitled "The World According to Dad" lists the kind of things that dads often say when asked why I should do something. Their answer is, because I said so. Do you want me to call your mother? Just wait until you have kids of your own. I hope one will be just like you. Yeah. Last Father's Day, my son gave me something, one father said. Something I always wanted. The keys to my car. One of my favorite is from Mark Twain. I can almost hear him. When I was a boy, at 14, my father was so ignorant I could hardly stand to be around that old man. But when I got to be about 21, I was astonished at how much he learned in 7 years. Yeah. But we watch those that are there. We watch those who are over us. And And we can thank them for the legacy that they passed behind this past few weeks. Some of you know my mom has moved into independent living, and that's caused all five of the children to kind of descend upon the house when we have time to do that. And especially for the three boys that are in Illinois, we've been there a lot. And this last particular trip, it was going through things and taking some things to our home. And it was just filled with memories. If you've done this before, you know exactly what's going on. Just filled with memories. Memories that are grand, most of them very favorable. Occasionally there may be some that are not as pleasant, but all in all, you know, good memories. But we want to make sure that what we do as fathers and as leaders, as mothers, as spiritual leaders in our homes, and as people who will make an impact to others, we want to make sure that we do what we need to do. One father looked back in his life and he had some regret in his life. He says, you know, I took my child to school, but not to church. I taught them how to drink, but not living water. I enrolled them in Little League, but not Sunday school. I showed them how to fish, but not to be fishers of men. I made the Lord's Day a holiday rather than a holy day. I taught them the church was full of hypocrites and made the greater hypocrite of them and me. I gave them a color TV, but provided no Bible. I handed them the keys to the car, but didn't give them the keys to the kingdom. I taught them how to make a living, but failed to bring them to Christ, who alone can make life. Oh, fathers have excellent opportunities to make an impact in their child's life, and the kids are always watching. You can thank fathers for material possessions and faithful instruction and for godly illustrations of their lives. We have a Heavenly Father, full of love and full of grace, and He indeed planned way ahead. From our epistle lesson to the Romans, Paul spoke these words, and these words were profound because he was inspired by the Holy Spirit to say these words. We don't hear Jesus speak these words specifically to his disciples, but yet his disciples discerned a Father's love through his Son, Jesus. God showed his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. For while we were still weak at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. That's looking ahead. That's planning in advance. That's doing something because he already knew the outcome. Just a couple weeks ago, I was working with a friend to replace the awning on my trailer camper. It had become frayed, and it was just a matter of time before it would just split and tear. We didn't want to be on a trip before it would split and tear. And as we were working on it, we were able to unroll it, roll it, and get it off. And if you've ever worked with a garage door, you looked at your garage doors, you see this really massive spring that's across a pole. Well, these awnings work on the same premise. One side has a spring to create this torsion, and the other side has a motor that moves, and you need to have this aligned just correctly. And so there's a piece that fits into the arms that come out, and that piece, of course, is wound with some tension on it. And as you take the piece out, the instructions say, carefully count how many backward turns, holding on carefully and letting that tension release so you know how many times to wind it back up. I'm saying that because that step was skipped. And it spun, and okay, so we're gonna have to figure this out. And then as we did get it all put together, and I was so pleased. It was so pretty. It wasn't ratty and nasty looking. It was just nice. It came out, but it wouldn't go back. Oh my goodness, it's not right. So make a long story short, we pushed it back, and we needed to take that piece out again. But remember, we wound it, and it was wound the wrong way. So Yeah, this is a pastor, so I could have made this a lot shorter, sure. So we're trying to ease it out, and the advice that was given was just push it out. We don't know how many times it was there, but just go ahead and let it pop out. And the person up there is going, well, there's a lot of tension here. I'm a little nervous. Well, caution to the wind a little bit, and it opened up and it spun. And as it spun, it hit the bracket and broke. And that piece that fits in there is a machined piece. It has to fit in just right. And no one was hurt, thank God. But what are we going to do? We have to buy a new piece. And time is of the essence. And you know how sometimes you can get parts quickly and things fast, but sometimes you have to wait a long time. We didn't have that. Well, the person says, you know, I think we could probably make another one. And so the two minds, not part of this mind, said, you know, maybe we could have two halves and splice it together and scrap it together. Maybe we could do this. And maybe we could do that. And they just talked about it. And I just was scratching my head going, ain't going to be no awning anymore. That's not true. I knew we'd figure something out. But we had to scrap the awning to the thing and just let it go. Well, it was revealed to me that as they were talking, the one person who was looking at it was, he already knew. He knew exactly how he was going to make it. He let his friend and brother in Christ talk to him, but he already knew how he was going to make the new piece. That just amazed me. But it was a great illustration of already knowing the final product in one's mind before it was even made. It was broken. And yet before it was repaired and made or fixed or made new, it was in the mindset, and so it was and is with our Heavenly Father. It was in his mindset. Jesus had been traveling throughout the region of Galilee, teaching in the synagogues, healing the sick, curing the disease. Crowds were gathering, and we're told that Jesus saw these people, parentheses, and already knew what he was going to do. But the Bible says he felt compassion on them. He felt compassion. And he was going to do something, and he knew what he was going to do. And like he had been doing in his whole ministry when he gathered these 12 to himself, he was going to lead by example. He was going to show them, and they were going to observe. For they themselves did not have that courage. They didn't have the wisdom, the knowledge. They were in the dust of the rabbi. They were watching him. He already knew what he was going to do. For he was already doing it. He had already, and here's something, just, you know, when you see a text that you've seen so many times, and I'm sure you've done this too, you read it again and you go, ah, something profound has come to me. Even before Jesus was in front of these people whom he was going to have compassion, he was already preaching the good news. He was already proclaiming the gospel because this was part of his plan already. God, you are so awesome. His wisdom is just so profound. And when we get that aha moment, do you think it's not amazing? Jesus was proclaiming the gospel message to the villages. He was teaching throughout the region of Galilee and in this place because and before he saw them to have compassion on them. He was equipping them with information and knowledge of who he is before they even had an opportunity. How amazing that is that he does this. And the disciples, I would think, witnessed it in awe. It's that awesomeness that we get when we open up the scriptures and we see something. I hear it every once in a while on Christian radio where someone will call in and say, you know, I was down, and then you played that song. And that's exactly what I needed at the exact time. That playlist may have been written or put together weeks ago. Who knows? Maybe months ago. That point of intersecting where God's love has been working in humanity, in society, in whatever ways, shapes, and forms he is, waiting for us to meet him. And he already knew that you would meet him there. And you hear that message. Today, it's happening right now. Someone in this room is going, aha, that's exactly what I needed to hear. I needed to know that when I was at this point, God was already on his way to meet me. And now I can look back and I see the wisdom of God and all the things that happened and why he brought me to this place. Thank you for revealing it to me, oh Heavenly Father. I don't always see it. It's not always revealed. But I see it now. I hear it now. And that's what Jesus was doing, equipping each of them up in the way that he should go. Now, I have a question for you. It's rhetorical. What does compassion look like? Especially as it's written in our gospel today in Matthew 9 and 10. He saw the crowds, he had compassion on them, and as revealed by the gospel writer of Matthew in this section, they were helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Perhaps that was revealed to Matthew in words later. When Jesus sat them down in words and in a situation that's not recorded in our scriptures, and he said, you know, when I saw them, my heart just ached. I saw them because this, and this is why we did, and he kind of unpacks for his disciples. And he shows them his heart. He shows them what he did and why he did as he was filled with compassion. As he was moved with compassion. And how wonderful that is as we hear and see what was going on. Preaching the gospel news itself. Giving proof of his divine character by miracles and healings which he performed, the kingdom of God was being proclaimed, not the kingdom of the world. There wasn't a temporal principality. There wasn't a social reform that he was proclaiming to them, but a common union, a communion of believers that were in union with him as he was their head. That means to be in the kingdom of heaven. If you are a living member of Christianity, you don't always just not only hear the belief, hear the gospel, but you believe it. Christ's ministry brought him into the most intimate touch with the people, with clear insight and compassion. He reached out and touched a neglected flock. A flock that had been hearing words of the world, hearing words of their, perhaps their priest or their rabbi. Perhaps they were listening to the Pharisees and the Sadducees and those who were of the church. They were trying to discern what a loving God is like who demands laws and rituals and works and righteousness that's performed by people. And yet now we have a situation where we have a man, God himself, Jesus, incarnate right in front of them, showing his heart and saying, this is what I'm talking about. Well, those scribes and those Pharisees, they were vexed. They were beside themselves. What do you do with love and compassion that's been given so freely and now is being given out so freely? Well, God took care of that too, didn't he? Jesus took care of that too. It says in Scripture that he calls the 12 to them. And as he's talking to them, he wants them to understand, you know, the harvest, there's a lot. Look at all the people. Look at all the possibilities. Open your eyes. Have the eyes of Jesus and see. There are people that need to hear the good news of Jesus. They need to feel the touch of his love. Look, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Step number one, pray. Pray that there would be more laborers in the field. pray that people who know Jesus Christ would be moved by the Holy Spirit to be the laborers in the field, to go and try to reap a harvest. Pray that the people that are filled with the good news of Jesus Christ, who go to Bible study and meet in their small groups and gather together in God's holy place every single week, sent as laborers into the vineyard, into the harvest, to gather the harvest. Knowing that he was sending them, he also realized that he needed to empower them to go forth so that they would be able to fulfill their commission. And he does that. As the 12 comes to them, all of them there, he doesn't leave them on their own. He doesn't. He gives them his Spirit. He gives them his strength. One author said it's like Sinai once again. God comes down in all his power. There he is in the mountain. And the people feared and trembled in the greatness of God. And now we have God incarnate, Jesus Christ, right there with them. All the power of God, all authority in heaven and on earth given to him. And he proclaims to them. He says, go. Go. And he gives them authority. He empowers them. Not just generally. I think we hear that a lot in church, a lot from the pulpit. You have the Spirit, Nicole. Now Jesus itemizes it. He says, I'm going to give you authority over unclean spirits, and you're going to be able to cast them out. I'm going to give you authority to heal every disease and every affliction. That's what I'm going to give you authority to do. You're going to proclaim, and you're going to be able to heal. You're going to be able to cast out. Your Heavenly Father loves you. Of course you know that. And he has called you to be his own. Each and every one of us. And he does what the Heavenly Father does, as we keep hearing that hopefully recurring theme and recurring message that you will take with you and you will not easily forget, because he's already washed you clean so that you can do it. He's washed you clean from sin so that you can go and do it. He's given you this information and it's locked in your mind and it's ready to be released. Because when you go into the world, you go into the harvest field, you're going to go to people who know that they're not perfect, who know that they've sinned, who know that they're unclean, and they're going to look at you and they're going to be ready to question and challenge. And you're going to say, you know what? I'm here to tell you the good news. And they're going to wait, and they're going to be pensive, they're going to be apprehensive, and then you might even say, well, before I go any further, let me tell you right now. I know what it is like to be unclean. I know what it is like to fail. I know what it is like to fall short and to doubt. I know what it's like to fear to the point almost of despair. I've been there. I know this. And I would not be able to come to you if my Heavenly Father didn't know it already. And while I was weak, while I was still in my sin, he sent his Son, Jesus. Because he knew that you and I would have a point of intersection today. And I would be able to share with you this wonderful message. And in doing that, you will have revealed what he has revealed to you, his heart. Revealing his heart to you so that you can reveal his heart to others. Do Jesus says that you've been instructed with my word, and now I want you to go. And he says, really interestingly, in this particular passage, he says, don't go to the Samaritans yet. Don't go to the Gentiles. He didn't say yet, but we know what happens. Go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel and proclaim as you go, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. They know the scriptures. They know the Torah. They know that what is going on here, Jesus knew it too. When you intersect with these people and you start talking to these people, you're going to reveal my heart. You're going to reveal the heart of the Father to them. And they're going to be able to connect the dots and to realize what you're saying. And then it's up to me, my spirit, to flip the switch of faith from doubt to belief. It's that spirit that you are being sent with. As the Father has given me, I'm sending you. I am empowering you with his spirit. Oh, yes. We need to be empowered. Oh, we need to be empowered. It's an amazing text. It's John 3:16 all rolled up in a whole other story, in a whole other illustration. For God so loved the world that he sent his only Son, that whoever believes will not perish but have eternal life. He came to seek and save the lost, and he wants us to be part of his Father's business. And that is who you are. I pray that you are moved with compassion. That you don't speak the words of that one father who spoke earlier and said, you know, he has so much regret. You want to speak the words of a faithful servant so that that day when you're called in to heaven, you'll hear those words, well done. Good and faithful. Well done. Enter into the joy of your master. Freely you've been given, freely received. In Jesus' name. May the Spirit of God keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus to life everlasting. Amen. Please stand now as we speak of the words of the Nicene Creed. Or we're going to sing the words of the Creed. It's 953.
Thank you.
God, we pray for the whole church throughout the world. As people united in faith and active in love, that we may witness to the good news that is ours in Christ Jesus. We pray for all nations of the earth, that in those places where strife and discord rule, there may be times of peace and reconciliation, lifting up Ukraine and Russia, lifting up difficulties in other nations, Lord. We ask that you would bless them with your presence and strength, that peace would prevail and that strife would cease. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunities to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ in our own nation. And we ask, Lord, that we would be that nation under one God, indivisible. But there is so much dividing. So we pray for unity. We also lift up some special petitions to you, to the throne of grace, as we pray for our families, especially on this Father's Day. We honor our fathers and grandfathers and great-grandfathers and father figures. We thank God for the blessings that are received from all caring parents in every generation. And we thank you, Lord, for the legacy of those who have passed on, and that we may keep their legacy alive, and that we may rejoice in our Heavenly Father. We thank you for listening to all of our petitions. As part of that petitioning, Lord, we ask that in the situations of daily life that we're placed in our workplaces, our neighborhoods, that we would be bringers of the good news in our actions as well as our words. We pray for those who have special needs, for Debbie Inman, dealing with a possible infection, recovering from hip surgery, for Carol, who's still looking for relief from pain, and for others of body, mind, and spirit, we lay before you, asking that you would indeed grant them peace, grace, mercy. Remember, Lord, all for whom you love and care, that we name in our hearts at this time. Father God, I thank and praise you that you are already the God of tomorrow, and that you know what's coming, and you've already made plans, and you've already worked things out. Help us to trust in your promises, to trust in your wisdom, to trust in your power, and to go forth equipped to speak the news to the world around us. I pray this in the strong and precious name of Jesus, my Savior. Amen. Please be seated now as we receive our tithes, offerings, and if you have prayer requests, you can include those in the plate that comes by. We will go ahead and sing the offering hymn while the offering is being taken.
Cross and break, and Lord, to
minds to receive that which comes to us in bread and wine, the very body and blood of our Lord Jesus, with a word of prayer. O Lord of heaven and earth, we bless you for having sent your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, to give himself as a perfect sacrifice for us, so that our lives may know true peace. We have been invited by your grace, and we come to your table as royal priests and a holy people, grateful for the welcome we receive there. Strengthen us through Christ's body and blood, that we may be people of faith and peace, joyfully awaiting the new heaven and the new earth that you promise to give us in your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. It was our Lord Jesus Christ who on the night in which he was betrayed took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples and said, take and eat. This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he also took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink of it, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. And so as often as we eat this body and bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Amen. Amen, Lord Jesus.
We pray. O Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, in giving us your body and blood to eat and to drink, you lead us to remember and confess your holy cross and passion, your blessed death, your rest in the tomb, your resurrection from the dead, your ascension into heaven, and your coming for the final judgment. So remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Come be,
yes, yes.
Thank you.
Please stand for the prayer of thanksgiving. Oh God, you have fed your grateful disciples with the true manna, the living bread from heaven, at your table of grace. We ask, Lord, and implore you that the body and blood of your Son would be our support throughout our earthly pilgrimage as we are sent as laborers into the harvest. And continue to strengthen us until we reach that land where there is neither hunger or thirst. We pray this through Jesus, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And now may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon and remain with you now and always. Amen. Our final song is, How Shall They Hear Who Have Not Heard? And may be seated. And Julie are there as well. We're the storytellers. And you know, and I just, there's only one person in there, and there's a lot of hands that helped. But I just want a round of applause and so much thanks. She put in hours and hours and hours. She's back there. She serves every Sunday. Would love for her to get another person that knows how to run maybe the camera thing and to do some of the ushering. And there's so much that she does. But Susan Gilbert, come on in. She's one of those humble servants, and wow, it would not have taken place if it wasn't for her. So thanks so much. And again, thank you for all the helping hands. It's something we can celebrate as we are a beacon in the community, equipped, empowered, and sharing the hope and love of Jesus.